scripture, which is John 12:12-26. I'd like to say that Jesus began his final week on earth by riding into Jerusalem on a donkey under a canopy of palm branches, with clouds hailing him as a king, to announce that he was indeed the Messiah. Jesus chose a time when all of Israel would be gathered in Jerusalem, a place where huge crowds would be. And so on Palm Sunday today, we celebrate Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem. The next day, the news that Jesus was on the way to Jerusalem swept through the city, a huge crowd of Passover visitors took palm branches and went down the road to meet them. And they shouted, "Praise God! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hail to the King of Israel." Jesus found a donkey and sat on it, fulfilling the prophecy that said, "Don't be afraid, people of Israel. Look, your king is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt." His disciples didn't realize at the time that this was a fulfillment of prophecy. But after Jesus entered into his glory, they remembered that these scriptures had come true before their very eyes. Those in the crowd who had seen Jesus call Lazarus back to life were telling others about it. And that's the main reason so many went to meet him, because they had heard about this mighty miracle. Then the Pharisees said to each other, "We're lost. Look, the whole world is going after him." Some Greeks who had come to Jerusalem to attend the Passover paid a visit to Philip, who was in Bethsaida in Galilee. They said, "Sir, we want to meet Jesus." So Philip told Andrew about it, and they went to ask Jesus. Jesus replied, "The time has come for the Son of Man to enter into his glory. The truth is, a kernel of wheat must be planted in the soil, and unless it dies, it will be alone, a single seed. But its death will produce many new kernels, a plentiful harvest of new lives. Those who love their life in this world will lose it. Those who despise their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. All those who want to be my disciples must come and follow me, because my servants must be where I am. And if they follow me, the Father will honor them." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Michael and Jill and the crowd. Appreciate the music. Sounds of hope. It's beautiful. And you can clap, you know, during music. I just want to clarify that. You know, we're not going to, you know, you have permission to clap during the music as well as after. You know, as a writer and one-time columnist, I have found that the hardest key to press on any keyboard is the delete key. There I'll go, writing words and putting sentences together that I think are just dynamite, ready to go, ready for the world, and then I'll read back over it, and it won't fit with the rest of the essay, or something's missing, and I have to highlight those sentences and press delete. Other times I'll write something that I think is pure magic, and then I'll read it, something will hit me, have to delete it. Now I've tried to be sneaky with it. Sometimes I'll go back over what I've written, and I cut it out, and I paste it onto a new document, maybe to save until later or to use, but you know, that's a bottomless abyss. And I never use those texts, even though they may be good, they just never seem to fit. It is hard to delete something from that which you're writing. Writers go on and on about how this is the most important work of a writer, to have the courage to delete something that you think is good. One writer likens it to killing your darlings. He says, "Kill your darlings. You may love it. It may be the best thing you've ever written. But if it doesn't fit, delete it. Cut it out." He said, "Usually when you cut something out, even if you love it, something better will take its place." You know, that's true. I've learned over the years that some things need to die in order for something else to flourish. There's an old church back in Atlanta that I knew about that was waning. They had decreased down to about 30 members and had a huge church right in the middle of Decatur. And in exploring God's movement, they came to the place where they had to sell the building, and rather than just calling quits, they took the money. They started to meet in another church and created an amazing ministry to caregivers and care receivers and loved ones who were at home. They had enough money from the sale of the building in order to bring in students from the seminary in order to teach them how to provide care and how to do in a different kind of way without a building. And it flourished to be, to this day, an effective ministry in that place. Some of you may know about the history of Apple computers. There were many times when Apple had to kill a few things in order to produce the kind of technology we know today. Along the way, I had to kill a time or two my Italian identity. You know, I say to people, sometimes my Italian comes out. And then I have to remind myself that I'm not, although I am Italian, that I'm a Christian first. Sometimes I need to put the Italian part of me on hold. When Jesus came to Jerusalem at the start of Holy Week, he came with a clear understanding that in order for us to live, he needed to die. Scripture tells us that his disciples didn't always understand this and certainly didn't understand this right away. The crowds were so busy chanting King of Israel that they too failed to see his deeper meaning. And even those who heard the title Son of Man probably didn't listen to the next few things that Jesus said when he mentioned that in order for him to be glorified, the chorus was to be crucified. And all of the signs and clues were there all along. You think of Holy Week and Palm Sunday specifically, of how Jesus symbolizes that his road was a very different road than others might take as Messiah. For instance, instead of coming in on a white horse of victory, he instead came in on a donkey, lowly. And rather than coming in the West Gate, where all of the leaders and the aristocrats and the governor would have entered surely on that first day of Passover, Jesus decides to enter in the East Gate. In fact, some scholars are convinced that when Jesus came in for that Holy Week, it could have been coincidentally in time, just right, at the same time that the aristocrats and the governors were coming in the West Gate. And if that wasn't enough to show the crowds that his idea of Messiah was different from their own, he said unequivocally that a grain of wheat needs to fall to the ground and die in order for it to produce fruit. And that those who want to save their life will indeed lose it. But those who despise their life will gain eternal life. It's another way of saying, as we follow Jesus on this road, that we too need, like Jesus, to press the delete button in order to see that the road to life sometimes is by way of pressing delete. But I think we have to have courage in order to do that. We need to muster in ourselves the courage to not cling to something so badly that takes the place of God in our life that we can't delete it. Now, for those of you out there who are Batman fans, I know at least one Batman fan in this room sitting over there with the same name as LaGuardia and the same Italian blood running through her. There is a scene in one of the contemporary Batman movies in which Bruce Wayne, Batman, is thrown into a prison down underground under this long shaft from which no one can escape. Now, one person, according to legend in this movie, did escape by climbing up that shaft and getting to a little platform where that person had to jump from that platform to another and then climb the rest of the way. Now, according to the movie, men in this prison have been trying to escape for years and years. They would tie a rope around their waist and climb up and get to that first platform, but as soon as they tried to jump to the next platform, they would fall and the rope would catch them. Bruce Wayne, being Batman, of course, had to try to escape, and so he tries a few times, falls, and he goes to a wise sage that befriended him in prison, and he says, how did that one person do it? And the wise sage said, well, legend is that that person didn't climb with the rope. So sure enough, Bruce Wayne had to climb that shaft without a rope, and without a rope, As if he despised his own life, he made that jump and escaped, and so Batman rose again. Sometimes we need to let the rope go. Sometimes we need to press delete. There's a story about an old clergyman, an author by the name of Frederick Buechner, who started out as a very popular author and heard God's call to ministry. He thought that his life as a writer was just fine, thank you very much. Why would God want him to be a minister? But the Holy Spirit moved on his life, and he had to make the decision to go to seminary. And he stated that his writing had to come to an end, that his seminary work and the life of his ministry should be born and begin. And that's when he wrote, he realized that in that moment that the very same God who offers us everything is the very same God who demands from us everything. Where do you need to press delete in your life? Now, some of us have tried to sterilize these hard calls of discipleship. We've tried to make light of them, like as if Jesus said, you don't really need to lose your life or despise it in order to have eternal life. Others of us have tried to make it about faith. All Jesus is saying is he wants more faith out of us. And though I agree that all of us can use a greater measure of faith, I'm really sure that that's not the direction Jesus was heading here. Rather, Jesus' call to discipleship demands a tougher question from us. This Holy Week, as in every Holy Week, we have to ask, I think, a deeper question, and that is, what is it that we need to not only delete in our life, but what is it that we need to bury with Jesus? What is it that you need to bury with Jesus? It's not enough to kill your darlings. You need to bury them with Jesus. Is it your selfish ambition? Is it pride or desire? Is it a sense of security that you long for apart from Christ? Are there distractions that get in Christ's way that not only you need to press delete, but also bury them? And what will make you go so far as to give the appearance that you despise your life for the sake of Christ? I have a calling story of my own when I too was called to ministry. It's not as witty as Frederick Buechner's, but I think you'll enjoy it. When I went to college, I had a decision to make. Was I going to become a lawyer or a minister or a teacher or some such sort? And I finally made the decision that I was going to go to the ministry. Upon returning to New York in order to be with family over a holiday, the family asked, oh, Joe, you're in college. What are you going to do with your life? What are you going to be? And I said, I'm going to go into the ministry. I was so proud. And everyone said, ministry? Do ministers make any money? Well, what do ministers do? And I think my aunt, my father's sister, really had the really important question. Wow, you don't like women? You don't want to get married? You're going to go to the ministry? I said, Aunt Phyllis, I'm not going to be a priest. This is like a Baptist minister. I can get married. Don't worry. Oh, all right. What is it that you need to press delete on? But the important question, what do you need to bury with Christ? You see, I've believed for a long time that cemeteries are haunted. I'm not talking about the haunted with ghosts and such, or arms that are going to break out of the earth and grab your ankle. But I'm talking about the things that are buried in the cemeteries, haunts that plague those who have gone before us, those regrets, those various things that hold people down. One preacher said at one time that there are two things buried in cemeteries, bodies and secrets. So the question we need to ask, what is it that we need to bury with Jesus in order to leave with Jesus? You see, Jesus is called to discipleship, especially in this passage, sounds especially dreadful. And for those who want to cling to their life with their dear life are going to find it dreadful. But those of you, many in this room, who have tasted the Lord and know that he is good, who have tasted and savored the sweetness of his presence, know that this hard call to discipleship is really the way to freedom. It's a way to bury those things that we need to put to rest, to put with Christ in that tomb those secrets and resentments and regrets that we need to leave at the cross. You see, Jesus died for our sins in the cross, but he bore much more than that. He bore those things that entangle us from our past life. Those things we might regret, the many ways that we are distracted, those things we need to delete. That's Jesus' burden to bear, and he asks us, especially this week, to lay them at the feet of the cross, to crucify them there, and to bury them with Jesus. You see, next week we'll be at it again. This music, which is beautiful, is just a preview of some of the joy we'll also experience next week. And when we come together next week, we will find on Easter Sunday that we will celebrate a risen Savior and come to find that the tomb is empty. Jesus is not there. And nothing else will be there either. If you're going to look to pick up whatever you leave at the cross, it won't be there if you bury it with Jesus. In fact, for all of the talk of death in John chapter 12, on this side of the cross, in John 12, the only talk of death we get after the cross, on the other side of the cross, later on in the gospel, is a question from an angel when the angel asks, "Why do you look for the living among the dead?" My fear for you, those of us who don't have the courage to press the delete button, is that we will have the opposite problem. We will look for the dead among the living. Those things we need to kill and put to rest and bury with Jesus. Why do you look for the dead among the living? That's the question we ask. Because once Jesus asks you to press delete, you need to realize it's gone. You can't put it in a file somewhere and save it for later in order to ruminate on it. You need to let the rope go so that you don't have a safety net, because once Christ calls you and compels you and draws you into his life, it's as if Jesus is saying, remember what he said, if you're to follow me, anyone who puts his hand to the plow cannot look back and be my disciple. He must follow me. What grief do you need to bear? What losses or things that create resentment in you that you need to bear? What are those various things you need to let Jesus have? So that when you wake up come Resurrection Sunday, not only will we have died with Christ in order to live in him, but those things that we need to put to rest will die once and for all. So today's call is a simple one, yet it's difficult. As Christ is calling you to look at the areas in your life that no longer fit, the words that no longer make sense, the various things in your life that get in God's way, and Jesus asks you to hit the delete button once and for all, will you have the courage to do it? Will you have courage to let those grains of wheat fall to the ground and die once and for all, that you might live and produce fruit? The Bible puts it a different way. Cast all your cares on Christ. My challenge to you is, once you cast all your cares on Christ, don't reel them back in. Amen. Let us pray.